come alive in Jesus' name. Thank you, Father, for answering. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Once again, it's a pleasure having you here in the house, and I pray the presence and the power of the Lord will be with you in Jesus' name. As we all have been hearing, that today is the day of resurrection. Your life will resurrect. Your family will resurrect. Your health will resurrect. Your finances will resurrect in Jesus' name. And spiritually, you will come alive in Jesus' name. Come with me as we look at the subject, victorious power of resurrection. The victorious power of resurrection. We have been told earlier on that there were people that died and they came back to life. The Shunammite, a woman, the son died and came back to life. The prophet Elisha died, but he never came back to life. However, he made that child to come to life. The child that came to life eventually died. Elisha himself eventually died. Not that alone, Jesus got to the graveside of Lazarus, brought him back to life. Lazarus finally died. The truth of the matter is, Jesus is the only one that died, rose again, and never died anymore. Which is the assurance that we have that by the grace and the power of the Lord, we will live forever with him in glory in Jesus' name. The victorious power of resurrection. There is power in this kind of resurrection. Not the previous resurrection, not any other resurrection, but the resurrection of Christ Jesus. Because of what it means to us, I look again at the book of John chapter 20 from verses 1 to 17. John chapter 20 verses 1 through to 17. The first day of the week, cometh Mary Magdalene early, when it was yet dark, unto the sepulchre, and seeth the stone taken away from the sepulchre. Then she returned and cometh to Simon Peter and to the other disciples whom Jesus loved, and said unto them, they have taken away the Lord out of the sepulchre, and we know not where they have laid him. Peter therefore went forth, and that other disciple, and came to the sepulchre. So they ran both together, and the other disciples did outrun Peter, and came forth to the sepulchre. And he, stooping down and looking in, saw the linen clothes lying, yet went he not in. Then cometh Simon Peter, following him, and went into the sepulchre, and seeth the linen clothes lie, and the napkins that was about his head, not lying with the linen clothes, but wrapped together in a place by itself. Then went in also that other disciples, came forth to the sepulchre, and he saw and believed. Somebody here today will believe. For as yet they knew not the scripture, that he must rise again from the dead. Then the disciples went away again unto their own home. But Mary stood without at the sepulchre, weeping. Your weeping will be over. I said, everything that makes you weep in life is over in Jesus' name. And as she wept, she stooped down and looked into the sepulchre, and saw two angels in white sitting, the one at the head and the other at the feet, where the body of Jesus had lain. And they say unto her, woman, why weepest thou? She said unto them, because they have taken away my Lord, and I know not where they laid him. And when she had thus said, she turned herself back and saw Jesus standing, and knew not that it was Jesus. Jesus said unto her, woman, why weepest thou? Whom seekest thou? She, supposing him to be the gardener, said unto him, sir, If thou have borne him thence, tell me whence thou hast led him, and I will take him away. Jesus said unto her, Mary. She turned herself and said unto him, Rabboni, which is to say, Master. Jesus said unto her, Touch me not, for I am not yet ascended to my Father, but go to my brethren, and say unto them, I ascend unto my Father and your Father, and to my God and your God. Here we see the account of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. And here we see the hope and the assurance that we have that though this mortal body will die, the normal natural first death, but that on the day of resurrection, we shall arise. And nothing, no death, no hell, no pang of death will keep us down in the grave in Jesus' name. But then it's not enough for us to know that Jesus died. Knowledge alone is not enough. What effect, what is the efficacy of the resurrection of Christ in your life? The efficacy of the resurrection of Christ in my life. What does it do? It's not enough that he died. Yes, he died. There is a purpose for his death. But he also rose again. There is also a purpose for his resurrection. Philippians chapter 3 verse 10. Philippians chapter 3 verse 10. That I may know him and the power of his resurrection. That is it. The power of his, not just the power of resurrection, but the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his suffering being made comfortable unto his death. The resurrection of Christ is the hope and the only believer's hope of life. Here on earth and in the world to come. Until Christ resurrects from the grave, all hopes were lost. The disciples went into hiding, and the persecutors of the just appeared jubilant for a moment. Wait a minute. Your enemy may have been rejoicing over you. It's for a moment of time. Your morning of joy will come. You will prevail in Jesus' name because it is written, heaven and earth will pass away, but not a jot or tittle of the word of God will pass unfulfilled in Jesus' name. No matter what your current situation may look like, remember, after the Friday of crucifixion came the Sunday morning of resurrection. Somebody here is going to resurrect in Jesus' name. People thought it's all over with you. It's all over for you. They thought that you are dead and buried forever. They thought you never make it in life. They thought all hope for you is all over. And the Lord is saying, you will resurrect. Dry bone will rise again. Can somebody shout, dry bone will rise again. And so shall it be for you in Jesus' name. You will arise. You will arise from your sickness. You will arise from your failure. You will arise from the life of defeat. You will arise from your life of shame. You will arise from gloom. You will arise from loss. You will arise from whatever the crisis of life may be in your life. You are coming out of debt in the name of Jesus. If you have been there living a life of sin or a life of up and down, instability spiritually, you are coming out of that. You are standing firm upon your most holy faith in the name of Jesus. If you have been there under the oppression of the enemy, oppression of the devil, affliction of the wicked one, you are coming out in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, because the resurrection power of God is coming upon your life in Jesus' name. If there is any societal dismay in your life, any illusion or illusionary relationship, the Lord is going to bring you out in Jesus' name. I look at John chapter 11, the book of John, Gospel according to St. John chapter 11, verses 25 and 26. Jesus said unto her, I am the resurrection and the life. And in the name, amen. And he that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die, shall never die. Believest thou this? Believest thou this? Believest thou this? That you will live and reign eternally with Christ in glory in Jesus' name. 1 Peter chapter 1 verse 3. 1 Peter chapter 1 verse 3. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to his abundant mercy hath begotten us again unto a lively hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. A lively hope, a living hope, a glorious hope, an eternal hope. The Lord has promised you in Jesus' name. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 21. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 21. For since by man came death, by man came also the resurrection of the dead. The Lord will bring you out. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, we are, as we look at the message, victorious power of resurrection. The victorious power of resurrection. We are going to consider the message under three main subheading. Number one, the victorious power of resurrection over depraved nature of sin. Over, maybe I should put it this way, the victorious power of resurrection over vile, depraved nature of sin. Vile, depraved nature. The word vile means dreadful, abominable, awful, revolting nature of sin that is depraved. Point number two is going to be the victorious power of resurrection over vicious, destructive diseases. Vicious, destructive diseases. And finally, the victorious power of resurrection over vicious demonic powers of darkness. Somebody is being liberated today. The victorious power of resurrection over vicious demonic power of darkness. Every power of the enemy in your life, the Lord will destroy them in Jesus' name through the power of resurrection. That is the lively hope that the resurrection of Christ has given unto us. It's not just that we live here in this world and then after that we rise again on the day of resurrection. No, he's telling us that anything that is literally seemingly looking dead in your life, while you are still here on this part of eternity, they are coming alive in Jesus' name. I come back to point number one. What's the point number one, everybody? The victorious power of resurrection over vile, depraved nature of sin. Romans chapter 3 verse 23 tells us that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. That is what this sin does. It makes you to be come short of the glory of God. It makes you, you know, when there is no grace in the life of a man, such a man is disgraced. That is what sin does. Sin disgraces you. Sin diminishes you. Sin deters you. Sin destroys you. Sin deforms you. All have sinned. By birth, we are sinners. By choice, we are sinners. All have sinned and come short, inadequate, incompetent, unqualified for the grace of God. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. But hear the word of God. What is the repercussion of sin? Romans chapter 6 verse 23. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. That is why Jesus came to die, to destroy the life and the nature of sin. And when sin is there, everything about you is dead. Everything about you is abnormal. But when Christ died, he destroys the power and effect of sin in your life. When he resurrects, he gives you another hope of a new life. Hope of a better life. Hope of a glorious life. Hope of a renewed life. And that will happen in Jesus' name. That's why it tells us in Matthew chapter 11, verses 28 and 29, come unto me. He's inviting you. Little child, God is inviting you. Youth, God is inviting you. Young adult, God is inviting you. Daddy, mommy, God is inviting you. Mr. Professional, Mrs. Professional, God is inviting you. Rich man, God is inviting you. Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. And I will give you rest. He said, take my yoke upon you. There is a yoke of sin that has been there. There is a yoke of the enemy that has been there. There is a yoke of spiritual and physical death that has been there because of sin. There is a yoke of satanic affliction, oppression that has been there. He's saying, if you come to me, all those will be taken away. The yoke of the consequences of sin that has been there. The yoke of condemnation and guilt that has been there. And then the yoke of the judgment of God and eternal perdition that has been there because of sin. He said, take my yoke upon you. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me. And learn of me. The Lord is calling you. He's calling everybody. He said, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest for your soul. And somebody here today is getting rest in Jesus' name. When you then come unto him, when you now desire this rest, what do? Acts of the Apostles, chapter 3, verse 19. Repent ye therefore and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out, when the times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord. Somebody here is going to repent. As you repent of your sin, you forsake them, you make a U-turn, you turn to the Lord, he shows you mercy. He forgives you. He receives you and makes you his own. The Bible says, behold, that is Revelation chapter 3, verse 20. Behold, I stand at the door and I knock. If any man will hear my voice and open the door, I will come in unto him. I will sup with him and he with me. Jesus is knocking on the door of your heart so that you can let him in, so that he can have his way, so that the vile, depraved nature of sin in your life can be removed and destroyed by the power of resurrection. And today, if you will just give up your religion, religion does not save anybody. If you just give up your knowledge, knowledge alone pops up. It does not save anybody. If you will just give up your position and your title, if you just give up the name of your church, the title of your church, if you give up everything, if you come just as you are, if you come with humility, if my people shall call by my name, will humble themselves, you come with humility, the mercy of God will find you. I said the mercy of God will find you in the name of Jesus. Romans chapter 6, verses 5 and 6. For if we have been planted together in the likeness of his death, you die with him. I am crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, but yet not I, but Christ lives in me. Come back to Romans. For if we have been planted together in the likeness of his death, we shall be also in the likeness of his resurrection, knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin. You will no longer be a slave to sin in Jesus' name. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 21 again. We read it before. Let's read it again. For since by man came death, by man came also the resurrection of the dead. God has a plan for your life, a plan for your life. Take advantage of it. Colossians chapter 2 is where I'm looking at. Verses 6 through to 12. Colossians chapter 2 from verse 6. As ye have therefore received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk ye in him. Stop right there. There are people, they came to church. They said they have received Christ into their lives. But there is nothing that has changed in their life. They came to Christ, according to them, but they're still walking in their old way of life. They came to Christ, according to them, they still speak the way they used to speak, act the way they used to act, talk the way they used to talk, dress the way they used to talk, they dress. The kind of walk that honors the devil, glorifies the devil, they are still doing all those work, and yet they say they come to Christ. They come to Christ, but Christ is not in them. Christ is not in them. He says, as ye have therefore received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk ye in him, rooted and built up in him, and established in the faith, as ye have been taught, abounding therein with thanksgiving. Every day of your life, you praise the Lord. You bless the Lord. Beware lest any man spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit, after the tradition of men, after the rudiment of the world, and not after Christ. Verse 9. For in him dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily, and ye are complete in him. Ye are complete in him. Ye are complete in him. I need a big amen. Which is the head of all principality and power. That is, Christ is the head, the overall boss, the superpower, the one that can never be compared with anyone, the head of all principality and power, and you are complete in him. Verse 11, in whom also ye are circumcised with the circumcision made without hands, in putting off the body of the saints of the flesh by the circumcision of Christ, buried with him in baptism, wherein also ye are risen with him through the faith of the operation of God, who hath raised him from the dead. It will happen in your life. If you then, once this victory that the resurrection of Christ brought, you know, when we, after somebody said, I am born again, I have accepted Christ into my life as my Lord and Savior, then that is something personal to you. It is a decision between your heart and the Lord. Nobody knew that. It is something you have done. And then, according to the scripture, we say, demonstrate that for the world to see. Demonstrate that for the world to know, and then you go through water baptism. And so when you are deep into the water by immersion, you go completely underneath the water. The water covers you. It means you are dead with Christ, and your sins are buried with him. At the point of you being raised up is an indication of your new life in Christ Jesus. You resurrect together with him, and that is what we are talking about today. That if you say you are a child of God, if you say you are born again, you must daily live a victorious life over the vile, depraved nature of sin. And then the Apostle Paul in Colossians chapter 3 now broke everything down for us. Colossians chapter 3 verse 1. It says, if ye then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ seated on the right hand of God. Set your affections on things above, not on the things on earth. For ye are dead, and your life is hid with Christ in God. When Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then shall ye also appear with him in glory. In glory. Mortify therefore your members which are upon the earth. Fornication, uncleanness, inordinate affection, evil concupiscence, and covetousness, which is idolatry. For which things sake the wrath of God cometh on the children of disobedience. in the which ye also walked some time, when ye lived in them. But now, ye also put off all this. If you say you are born again, if you say you are saved by grace, if you say you are a child of God, if you say the blood of Jesus has washed you clean, put off all this anger, wrath, malice, blasphemy. Feel the communication out of your mouth. Lie not one to another, seeing that ye have put off the old man with his deed, and have put on. When you put off something, you put on something else. When you put off the dirty clothes, you put on new clothes upon yourself, and have put on the new man, which is renewed in knowledge after the image of him that created him, where there is neither Greek nor Jew, circumcision or uncircumcision, barbarian, Scythian, bond nor free, but Christ is all and in all. It simply means, whether you are white or black, whether you are American or European, whether you are African or you are Arabian, once you are in Christ Jesus, we become members of the same family. We live the same life. We speak the same thing. We act the same way. And your race, your tribe, your color, your status is nothing. All those becomes inferior to your relationship in Christ Jesus. Verse 12, put on therefore, as the elect of God, holy and beloved bowers of mercy, kindness, humbleness of mind. A lot of believers today are proud. Humbleness of mind, meekness, long-suffering, forbearing one another, and forgiving one another. There are many, many today that are still bearing grudges, animosity. There is no forgiveness for the sin or the error or the misdeeds of other people. It says, forbearing one another and forgiving one another. If any man have a quarrel against any, even as Christ forgave you, so also do ye. I need an amen. And above all these things, put on charity, put on love, which is the bond of perfectness, and let the peace of God rule in your heart, to the which also ye are called in one body, and be ye thankful. No matter what is going on in your life, be grateful unto God. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your heart to the Lord. Amen. And whatsoever you do, brother, whatsoever you do, sister, do in word or in deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God and the Father by him. Wives, submit yourselves unto your own husband, as it is fit in the Lord. Husbands, love your wives, and be not bitter against them. Children, obey your parents in all things, for this is well pleasing unto the Lord. Fathers, provoke not your children to anger, lest they be discouraged. Servants, obey in all things your masters, according to the flesh, not with eye service of men pleasers, but in singleness of heart, fearing God. And whatsoever you do, do it heartily, as to the Lord, and not unto men, knowing that of the Lord ye shall receive the reward of the inheritance. There is an inheritance for you, for ye serve the Lord Christ. But he that doeth wrong shall receive for the wrong which he has done, and there is no respecter of person. So we see the word of God dealt with different classes and categories of people, and how we must live this newness of life, victorious life over the vile, depraved nature of sin, and not a life of unbeliever anymore. And the Lord will give us the grace in Jesus' name. That is what the power of resurrection can do, and that is what it will do now. The power of resurrection is not only to make us live over and above sin. There are a lot of problems in the world, situations and circumstances in the world, sicknesses and diseases in the world that are also there confronting humanity. And the devil has no respect for anybody. Whether you're a priest or you are a pew member, it's not the issue. The devil will want to try his hands upon you. Pay attention here. The resurrection of Christ puts power over, puts power in your hand over the forces and the powers of darkness, and you will prevail in Jesus' name. Jesus said, "Behold, I give unto you power to tread upon serpents and scorpions, and over all the powers of the enemy, and nothing shall by enemies hurt you." To be vicious, as I get to the second point, victorious power of resurrection over vicious, destructive disease. To be vicious is to be malicious. Pay attention, the devil is keeping malice against you, whether you like it or not. The devil is spiteful of you. He's ready to be brutal in whatsoever he does to you. He's ready to be very, very nasty. That is what that word vicious is all about. And, to be vicious is to be venomous. Venom. The venom of a snake or the venom of a scorpion, when it gets into the body of a man, is deadly, is destructive. And so, when disease comes, and you can tell, as we are all going through the crisis of coronavirus in our own time, something that has never happened, now a state of emergency has been declared in the whole 50 states of the United States, which has never happened before. And a lot of people have died worldwide. Over 100,000 people have died. Here in the United States alone, more than 20,000 people have died. If you are on the prayer line within the week, one of those days, you remember when I said somebody should count 1 to 500. How many of you were there? Okay, God bless you. And then one of the few people were trying to count, but one of them in particular began to count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. And he was so fast, she was so fast doing the counting. By the time she got into like 80 something, the temple was going down, get to 100 and something. Finally, by the time she got into 180 something, she busted into laughter. She really couldn't continue. I said, "Now let me tell you why I asked you to count." As at that time, the people that have died in the United States alone were 14,700 and something. I said, "You were to count 500. You couldn't easily go through, even with the speed with which you were counting. 1, 2, 3, I said, now we are talking about human beings. And then you are seeing the body, human body. These are not just numbers. These are people now. And then you say, this is one body, 1, 2, 3. And now you begin to count, and then you count up to 1,000. And then you count up to 2,000. Up to 5,000, up to 10,000, and right now, as we speak right now, it's over 20,000 dead bodies. It's a terrible, terrible situation. And why? Because of one disease, one virus. Out of so many viruses in the world, just one of them has devastated the whole world. Just one of them has become so vicious, so deadly, so venomous that economies of the world have come to a standstill. That is how terrible a disease can be. When it afflicts a person, when it afflicts a family, when it afflicts a community, a nation, or the world at large, you have money, your money becomes useless. I was told, I didn't read that myself, but I was told at some point in China, people that had money were throwing their money away because money has failed. Money was powerless. Money could not save their life. And now here in America, you see, the celebrities are dying. The rich people are dying. The poor people are dying. It doesn't matter who you are. Disease can be deadly and destructive. The Lord will deliver us from them all in Jesus' name. Proverbs chapter 17, verse 22. Proverbs 17. A merry heart doeth good, like a medicine. But a broken spirit drieth the bones. dried the bones. Psalm 103, verses 2 and 3. Psalm 103. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgiveth all thy iniquities. Stop right there. Who forgiveth all thy iniquities? You want the resurrection power of the Lord in your life to be effective and efficient? You have to repent of your sin, confess them to the Lord, accept the Lord Jesus into your heart as your Lord and your Savior. And then when that is done, he will give you every other thing. He will do for you every other thing. He said, who forgiveth all thy iniquity? Not a single one was left unforgiven. When you confess everything, repent of everything, you turn over everything unto him, he forgives all your iniquity. And then he went further to say, he does not only forgive all your iniquity, he also healeth all thy diseases. I need an amen. Somebody here is getting healed today in Jesus' name. At the end of the ministration, we are going to pray. And I'm happy and grateful that because yesterday, our Father in the Lord, the General Superintendent, also prayed for people that are sick. And we are going to top it today in Jesus' name. He forgiveth all thy iniquities. If your iniquity has been forgiven, you don't live in sin anymore. You don't go back to that sin anymore. He healeth all thy diseases. And please pay attention. It is something that he has done, he is doing, he will continue to do for those that will call upon him in Jesus' name. Matthew chapter 10 verse 1. Matthew chapter 10 verse 1. If you are born again here, can you shout amen? Amen. If you have been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb, can you shout amen? Amen. If you are hopeful of making it to heaven, can you shout amen? Amen. If you are a disciple and a follower of Christ, can you shout amen? Amen. You know, a day of resurrection is a day of jubilation. Day of resurrection is a day of joy. It's a day of hope rekindled. And I have a good news for you. Matthew chapter 10 verse 1. As a child of God, as the redeemed of the Lord, as an heaven-bound pilgrim, it says, and when he had called unto him his 12 disciples, what did he do? He gave them what? Power. Somebody say power. Somebody say power. Somebody say power. It's coming your way in Jesus' name. He gave them power against or over unclean spirits to cast them out and to heal all manner of sickness and all manner of disease. Pay attention here. I have a good news for you. You don't have to wait for any pastor to demonstrate this power. The power is here with you. The power is there with you. The power is there with you. The power is there with you. And it will work for you in Jesus' name. Matthew chapter 19 verse 26. But Jesus beheld them and said unto them, with men this is impossible, but with God all things are possible. I don't care the kind of sickness or disease you are dealing with or battling with it. With God, all things are possible. I don't care for how long the problem has been there. And maybe you have been told that this is incurable. Hear me. No matter where you are, under the sound of my voice, I'm saying unto you, with God, all things are possible. That disease will not take your life. That sickness will not destroy you. You are coming out of it in Jesus' name. With God, all things are possible. It says, with men, this is impossible. The doctors may look at it impossible. The nurses may say it is impossible. Your parents may say it is impossible. Science may say it's impossible. But with God, how many things? All things are possible. First Peter chapter 2, verse 24. First Peter chapter 2, verse 24. Who his own self bear our sins in his own body on the tree, that we being dead to sin should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes, tell me, you were healed. Somebody here is healed. You won't live here the same way you came. In the name of Jesus. And James went further to tell us, the apostle James, in the fifth chapter, James chapter 5 verse 15, he says, and the prayer of faith shall save the sick. Can you see the word save used for the sick? So salvation is not only for sinner. When you are saved, when you are delivered, you are liberated, you are set free, and the prayer of faith shall save the sick, and the Lord shall raise him up. And if he have committed sins, they shall be forgiven. So then, is any sick among us today? Let such a person call upon the elders of the church. Let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the person is healed. I said the person is healed. In the name of Jesus. Let me tell you the mind of God for you. The desire of God for you. If you're a child of God, you know, parents care for their children. God is our Heavenly Father. He cares for us. He's concerned about us. The pastor that moderated earlier on, in the announcement, he said, if you have any issue and you have been affected in any way by COVID-19, let your pastor know. If we as a church can be so concerned about caring for you, concerned about your physical well-being, concerned about your spiritual well-being, how much more your Heavenly Father. Your Heavenly Father, hear the word of the Lord. Third John chapter 1 verse 2. Third John. It says, Beloved, the redeemed, pilgrims to heaven, saved soul, saints of God, beloved, I wish above all things. That is it. That is the mind of God. Above all things. Above all things. I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper. I declare in the name of the Lord you will prosper. I say you will prosper. I desire, I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper and be in health. Even as thy soul prospereth, every form of sickness in your body, disease in your body, the resurrection power of the Lord will blot them out in Jesus' name. If that is going to happen, it won't happen while you are still in sin. If that is going to happen, it won't happen while you are still covering your sin. Whosoever that covers his sin shall not prosper. But whosoever that will confess and forsake, not that you keep on coming and confessing, but you confess and forsake shall have mercy. James chapter 5 verse 16. Confess your faults one to another. Don't be proud about it. Don't just talk about restitution without doing it. Confess your faults one to another. If my people shall call by my name, will humble themselves, confess your first one to another, and pray one for another. When a brother comes, a sister comes and say, I am sorry for this or that that I have done, that is not the time for you now to begin to take advantage of the individual. You just join hands together. You pray together. Confess your first one to another. When somebody comes to confess us, not the time to say, oh, I never knew you are this evil and devilish and satanic. No. Confess your first one to another, and then what do you do for one another? You pray for one another that ye may be healed. The effectual, consistent, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. Now you see, the prayer that gets answered is the prayer of a righteous man. The prayer that gets the attention of God is the prayer of a righteous woman. The effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man. There are people that tell you, we are praying. They pray in the morning, they pray at noon, they pray in the night. They pray in every situation. Before they eat, they pray. Before they go out, they pray. When they get inside their vehicle, they pray. When they are standing up, they pray. When they are sitting down, they pray. When they are lying down, they pray. There is nothing wrong in prayer, but prayer without righteousness is in vain. The prayer that gets results is the effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous person. You'll be righteous. In the name of Jesus. Isaiah chapter 41 verse 10. Isaiah 41, fear thou not, for I am with thee. Be not dismayed, for I am thy God. I will strengthen thee. Yea, I will help thee. Yea, I will uphold thee with the right hand of my righteousness. I need an amen. And I will do it for you in Jesus' name. Finally, it says, Jeremiah 33, verse 6. It says, behold, Jeremiah 33, verse 6. Behold, look at it. Pay attention. Consider it. Jeremiah 33, verse 6. Behold, I will bring it health and cure. I need a better one. And I will cure them and will reveal unto them the abundance of peace and truth. So shall it be in Jesus' name. We get to the final point, the victorious power of resurrection over vicious demonic powers of darkness. The resurrection power of Christ has power over the nature of sin, has power over diseases, has power over devil and demons. And no matter the conglomeration of the forces of darkness, the power of the word of God will dismantle them, will destroy them. Colossians chapter 1 verse 13. Who have delivered us? Somebody here is delivered. It's like somebody went to bed. I said, who have delivered us from the power of the of darkness and have translated us into the kingdom of his dear son. Somebody here is delivered in Jesus' name. From the powers of the enemy, from the afflictions, from torments, from oppression, from nightmare, from failure, from disappointment, from every evil that has followed you all your life, from every covenant that works against you, you are delivered in Jesus' name. Who has delivered us? This is in the past tense. Delivered. Not that you are going to be delivered. By the time you turn over your life to Christ, you are delivered completely in Jesus' name. And it says, from the power of darkness. The power of darkness. And then you have been translated, you have been promoted, you have been elevated into the kingdom of his dear son. Luke chapter 22, verse 53. Luke 22, verse 53. When I was daily with you in the temple, you stretched forth no hands against me, but this is your hour and the power of darkness. Now Jesus is saying that the age in which we are in is the hour and the age of the powers of darkness. So to live a victorious life, you need a stronger power, a higher power, the power of the God of heaven, and is coming your way in Jesus' name. Luke chapter 10, I look at it from verse 17. And the 70 returned again with joy. Somebody here is returning with joy. Somebody, after visiting the Lord, meeting with the Lord, encountering the Lord, your situation is going to become joyful in Jesus' name. And the 70 returned again with joy. Again with joy. Again with joy. Pay attention here. It simply means they went before. They were victorious. They had power over principalities and powers. And then they came back with joy, with testimony. The Lord will put testimony in your mouth in Jesus' name. And then they went again this time, and then they came. That's what the Bible says. The 70 returned again. Every day of your life, testimony galore in Jesus' name. And the 70 returned again with joy, saying, Lord, even the devils are subject unto us through thy name. Through thy name. Through thy name. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, we have the victory. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, Satan, you have to flee. Hallelujah. When we pray in the name of Jesus, tell me who has the power to oppose. In the name. name of mighty Jesus, we have the victory. Amen. Amen. Verse 18, we are still in Luke chapter 10, verse 18. And he said unto them, behold, I beheld Satan as lightning fall from heaven. Behold, verse 19, I give unto you what? Power to tread on serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by enemies hurt you. I need an amen. Nothing shall hurt you in Jesus' name. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. That's why I use that word veracious. Something that you can verify. You can see the activities of the enemy. You can see how much you are laboring, but you cannot make progress. You can see how much you are sowing, but there is nothing to harvest. You can see how much you are praying, but there seems to be no answer. Vicious demonic powers of darkness. Behold, I give unto you power to tread upon serpents and scorpions. The power of the Lord given unto us will destroy them all in Jesus' name. That power is given us to open the eyes of the blind, to tumble from darkness unto light, and from the power of Satan unto God. That's what Acts chapter 26 tells us. This power includes the power of the enemy, the power of the devil. It includes the power of evil spirits and demon spirits. It includes the power of principalities and power. It includes the power of witches and wizards. It includes the power of occult magic and spiritualists that we are going to prevail over. All of them, you prevail over them in Jesus' name. I say you prevail over them in Jesus' name. Come again to that Ephesians chapter 6 verse 12. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood. We are not fighting against flesh and blood. We are not at war against flesh and blood. To wrestle is to get into a battle, is to get into a fight. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Are you ready for battle? I said, are you ready for battle? Stand upon your feet. It is time for us to get engaged in the battle. To get engaged in the battle. In the battle, in the battle, in the battle. Again, we'll sing that song. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. We have the victory. We have the victory. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Satan, you have to flee, hallelujah. When we pray in the name of Jesus, tell me who has the power to oppose. In the name of mighty Jesus, we are the victory. Oh Lord, come down and manifest your power. Oh Lord, come down and manifest your power. Oh Lord, come down, come and manifest your power. Oh Lord, come down and manifest your power. Healing power, saving power, come and manifest your power. Oh Lord, come down and manifest your power. That wonderful name, Jesus. That wonderful name. In your house, wherever you are, begin to sing unto the Lord. He said, resurrection money, resurrection power, resurrection victory. Yes, there is no other name like the name of the Lord Jesus. that wonderful name, Jesus, that wonderful name, Jesus, that wonderful name. Bless the name of the Lord right now. Begin to appreciate the name of the Lord. Before we get into the real realm of prayer, begin to worship Him. Begin to worship Him. Begin to glorify the Lord. Magnify the Lord. Magnify the Lord. Exalt Him. Exalt Him. Exalt Him. The God of heaven. He gave us the best that He has. Even His Son, Jesus Christ, to die for us on the cross of Calvary, to take our sin away, to make us free, to liberate us, to prepare us for heaven, to prepare heaven for us. Bless the name of the Lord. He became our sin. He was the propitiation of our sin. He was made a sin that has no sin. Just worship Him. Just honor Him. Bless the Lord. Because the word of the Lord never fell to the ground. The prophecy about the coming of Christ came thousands of years before Jesus came. And it was fulfilled. Bless the Lord. Worship Him. Glorify Him. Glorify, magnify Him. Magnify the name of the Lord. The Bible says that I may know Him and the power of His resurrection. And the power of His resurrection. Begin to pray right now. Resurrection power, come to walk in my life. Come to walk in my life. The resurrection power, do something in my life. Today, today, do something in my life. The resurrection power, do something in my life. Today, today, do something in my life. Oh, the resurrection power, do something in my home. Today, today, do something in my home. The resurrection power, do something in my life. Today, today, do something in our church. The resurrection power, do something in our church. Today, today, do something in our church. The resurrection power, do something in the church. Today, today, do something. Begin to pray that the resurrection power will do something in your life, something in your home, something in our church. If you are not yet born again, or if you are rising and falling in sin, the resurrection power of the Lord is available today to make you stand and never fall anymore, to make you whole, to make you free from the nature of sin, from the power of sin, from the sting of sin and the effect of sin. In the name of Jesus, begin to declare right now. Confess your sins. Confess your wrongs. Confess your faults. Confess to the Lord. Invite Jesus into your heart. Invite Jesus into your soul. Invite Jesus right now to be your Lord and Savior. In the name of Jesus, tell Him to wash you clean. Wash you clean with the precious blood of the Lord. Tell God to wash you clean with the precious blood of His Son, Jesus Christ, that was shed for the remission of your sin. Now is the accepted time. Today is the day of salvation. Yes. Do something. Do something. Do something. Resurrection power. He shall come to pass that whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Don't say I belong to the church. You must belong to the church of Christ, the church of the redeemed, the church of the saints, the elect of God. Let the resurrection power of the Lord do something in your life. Don't say I'm a worker in the church. I have position or title. It will amount to nothing in the day of judgment. The resurrection power of the Lord is available today. It's available today. The resurrection power. Do something in my life. Call upon the Lord.